announces sanctions on 5 extremist settler Israelis. Trump names J.D. Vance as his vice presidential running mate. Good afternoon and Salam Malaysia Madani. Thanks for tuning in. You're watching World Today with me, Daryl Baptist. The European Union on Monday announced sanctions on 5 Israelis, including those termed extremist settlers, and 3 organizations for abuses against Palestinians in the West Bank and blocking humanitarian aid to Gaza. The asset freezes and visa bans are the second round of sanctions from the 27-nation bloc targeting violent Israeli settlers, taking the total number of listings to 14. Prominent settlers blacklisted by the European Union included Moshe Sharvit, Zvi Bar Yosef, Baruch Marzel, and Issachar Mane. Both Gopstein and Mane have also been sanctioned by the United States, which Washington said last week opposes Jewish assimilation with non-Jews and agitates against Arabs in the name of religion and national security. Israeli organization Svav 9 was also sanctioned for regularly blocking humanitarian aid trucks, delivering food, water, and fuel to Gaza through violent protests. Also on the list were Baruch Marzel, who was openly calling for an ethnic cleansing of the Palestinians. The European Union sanctions under the EU Global Human Rights Sanctions regime include an asset freeze and a travel ban to the EU countries, including Monday's listings, 113 natural and legal persons and 31 entities from a range of countries have been sanctioned under the regime. Pakistan is planning to ban former Prime Minister Imran Khan's political party and move the country's top court to press treason charges against him. The country's information minister, Ataullah Tarar, told reporters the government would now bring a case to ban Pakistan's Tehreek-e-Insaf, also known as PTI, to the Supreme Court.
The minister said the move to ban PTI was based on the proven charge of the party receiving foreign funds from sources that are illegal in Pakistan, as well as rioting by the supporters last year that targeted military installations. A PTI spokesman said in a statement that the bid to formally ban the party is a sign of panic. The Human Rights Commission of Pakistan called the attempt to ban PTI an enormous blow to democratic norms and said it reeks of political desperation. Former cricket star Khan was ousted in 2022 before launching a comeback campaign in which he criticized Pakistan's powerful generals and drew massive crowds onto streets across the country. His arrest on corruption charges last year saw supporters storm military buildings and unleash a crackdown against his Pakistan Tehreek-e-Insaf, or PTI, party, culminating in elections marred by allegations of pre-poll rigging.
Over in the US, Donald Trump won formal nomination Monday as the Republican presidential candidate and picked a right-wing loyalist for running mate, kicking off a triumphalist party convention in the wake of last weekend's failed assassination attempt. Trump announced 39-year-old Ohio Senator J.D. Vance as his vice presidential pick, rewarding a one-time harsh critic who became one of his most reliable and uncompromising supporters in Congress.
Trump, 78, is guaranteed a hero's welcome at the convention in Milwaukee, where delegates delivered their formal nomination 2 days after the former president survived an assassination attempt at a rally. Vance had been widely expected as Trump's pick. He will bolster the ticket on the right wing, but with less chance of expanding appeal to more moderate voters and women. The standard bearer for a new kind of populism that has come to the fore under Trump, Vance is also one of the least experienced vice president picks in modern history. He initially made his name with the 2016 memoir, Hillbilly Elegy, a best-selling account of his Appalachian family and modest Rust Belt upbringing, which gave a voice to rural, working-class resentment in left-behind America. Turning his back on previous opposition to Trump, Vance reinvented himself and ultimately won the ex-president's key endorsement in the 2022 Ohio Senate race, launching his meteoric rise.
United States Federal Reserve Chair Jerome Powell said on Monday the three inflation readings over the second quarter of this year showed more progress was being made on bringing the pace of price increases back to the Fed's target. Powell's remarks are likely his last until his press conference following the Fed's 30 to 31st July meeting.
Inflation is edging closer to the central bank's 2% target, and policymakers are increasingly concerned about slowing the economy too much and causing the unemployment rate to rise. Given what policymakers believe to be an increasingly balanced set of risks, they may well use their final comments ahead of this month's meeting to either flag that rate cuts are imminent or explain why recent data still doesn't warrant a turn to easier monetary policy. The betting among investors has tilted strongly towards the Fed starting rate cuts in September. Changes to the policy statement in July could provide a strong signal of that by updating how inflation is described and assessing how recent data has added to policymakers' confidence that the pandemic-era outbreak of inflation has subsided.
Syria President Bashar al-Assad said on Monday he would only meet Turkish President Tayyip Erdogan if the two countries could focus on the core issues of pulling out Turkish forces from Syrian territory. Assad told reporters in Damascus that the problem is not the meeting, but its content.
Turkey severed ties with Syria in 2011 after the outbreak of the Syrian civil war, in which it supported rebels looking to oust Assad. The Syrian leader views the rebels as terrorists. Ankara also established a safe zone in northern Syria where Turkish troops are now stationed, and it has carried out several cross-border military operations against those it says threaten Turkey's national security. Erdogan said earlier in July he would extend an invitation to Assad anytime for possible talks to restore relations. Assad also said that he would respond positively to any initiative aimed at improving bilateral ties, but that the basis for such talks must be set first.
Greek politician Freddy Bellary arrived in Athens on Monday after leaving an Albanian jail to travel to Strasbourg to take the oath as a European Parliament lawmaker, but will return to serve his sentence on vote-buying charges. Bellary won a seat in Parliament as a candidate for Greek Prime Minister's Kyriakos Mitsotakis Conservative New Democracy Party.
Bellary was welcomed by a cheering crowd at the airport in Athens. He later met with Mitsotakis in Athens, who said he hoped Bellary would soon be free. Bellary will be sworn in later today and must return to prison on 20th July. It remains unclear how he will carry out his role as a member of European Parliament, or MEP, during the remainder of his time in prison. He was arrested in May 2023 during a mayoral election campaign in his hometown of Himare. He subsequently won the vote but was never sworn in while being held in pre-trial detention before being jailed for 2 years in March this year for election fraud. Earlier this month, he lost an appeal which upheld his conviction on vote buying from a lower court. Bellary has accused Albanian Prime Minister Edi Rama of organizing a plot against him, something repeatedly denied by Rama, who says it was all judicial, not a political matter.
More sad news as a rescue team on the Spanish island of Tenerife on Monday found human remains in the area where British teenager Jay Slater went missing nearly a month ago. Evidence strongly suggests they are his. The Guardia Civil Police Force said in a statement that he may have died due to a fall in the mountainous area, but that an autopsy would confirm whether it was an accident.
The family has been notified and an autopsy will take place shortly, with the case being transferred to a Tenerife court to determine the cause of death. Slater, 19, went missing on 17th June and his phone was last traced to the Masca Ravine in a remote national park on the Canary Islands archipelago. On 30th June, Spanish police said they had ended a search for Slater that had involved dozens of officers, rescue workers, and volunteers using dogs, drones, and a helicopter. However, on Monday, they said Guardia civil officers had maintained a continuous and discreet search in the area for the whole 29 days. British Overseas Missing Persons Charity, LBT Global, said in an email that the body found looks to be that of Jay Slater. The remains were found with Slater's possessions and clothes, and it is understood it was discovered close to the site of his mobile phone's last location.
Bolivian President Luis Arce on Monday announced the discovery of a 1.7 trillion cubic feet, or TCF, natural gas reserve located north of the country's administrative capital, La Paz. Arce said the field has been named the Mayaya Centro X1IE field and will be part of Bolivian government-owned oil and gas company YPFB's upstream reactivation plan.
El desarrollo inicial de tres pozos más y la construcción del ducto de interconexión para la producción de hasta 10 millones de metros cúbicos de gas y de 500 a 1000 barriles de petróleo por día, siendo esto en términos de ingresos para la población aproximadamente de 6.800 millones de dólares en la vida total de este proyecto.
The Mayaya Centro X1 field will add Bolivia's existing gas reserves, which stood at 8.95 TCF in December 2018, the most recent official data available. Bolivia's natural gas production decreased from 56.6 million cubic meters per day, or MMM3D, in 2016 to 31.9 MMM3D in 2023. The landlocked South American nation is facing an energy crunch linked to years of declining oil and gas production that has hit the country's currency reserves. The state energy firm YPFB said earlier this month it is looking for ways to overcome recent fuel shortages.
Coming up next, Armenia and United States begin joint military drills. Armenia and the United States will hold joint military exercises in Armenia that are expected to last until 24th July. The Armenian Defense Ministry announced the matter on Monday as it released footage of a parade marking the event.
The ministry said the Eagle Partner 2024 exercise will focus on tasks related to peacekeeping missions, and such drills with partner countries are regular. The purpose of the exercise is to enhance the interoperability of units participating in international peacekeeping missions, exchange best practices in control and tactical communication, and improve the readiness of the Armenian unit. Armenia, until recently Russia's closest South Caucasus ally, has seen its ties with Moscow sour in recent years over what Yerevan sees as Russia's failure to defend it from neighboring Azerbaijan. Russian Deputy Foreign Minister Mikhail Galuzin said on Thursday that by cooperating with NATO, Armenia risks destabilizing the South Caucasus and is undermining its own security. Galuzin said Moscow was unhappy with the fact that Yerevan had taken part in the NATO summit in Washington.
UNICEF on Monday said approximately 50,000 people have sought refuge in Kadarif in eastern Sudan, with authorities expecting even more in the coming days. Nasra Islan, a program coordinator for UNICEF, said a center for internally displaced registered at least 400 children up to 9th July.
War erupted in April last year between the Sudanese army and the paramilitary rapid support forces, or RSF, over the interrogation of the forces in a transition to free elections. On Thursday, only one of Sudan's warring parties showed up for UN-led talks aimed at brokering possible local ceasefires to facilitate aid and protect civilians. The war has sparked waves of ethically driven violence blamed largely on the RSF. The UN says nearly 25 million people half of Sudan's population need aid, famine is looming, and almost 10 million people have fled their homes. UN spokesperson Stefan Dujarric said in New York that the talks in Geneva have been convened by UN Sudan mediator Ramtane Lamamra. A UN spokesperson in Geneva said the parties would negotiate via Lamamra instead of meeting face to face. Dujarric declined to say which party did not show up for the talks.
Romanian lawmakers more than doubled the annual number of legal bear kills on Monday to control the population and avoid further attacks against people. The emergency parliamentary session followed the death last week of a 19-year-old hiker who was attacked by a bear on a popular trail in the Carpathian Mountains in central Romania.
The country has Europe's largest population of brown bears outside Russia. The European Union state has annual quotas to proactively control the size of the bear population and to remove animals that have been accustomed to entering cities in search of food. In 2023, the quotas amounted to 220 annual bear kills. On Monday, lawmakers increased the number to 481 per year. With hundreds of bear sightings each year, authorities are struggling to keep residents and tourists in mountain towns safe from wild animals. Local media regularly report bear attacks on people and livestock.
On a happier note, two sets of four rare tiger cubs were born on the same day at a zoo in Barnaul, Russia. According to an announcement by the zoo, the cubs from Siberian and Bengal mothers are now 2 weeks old and are making their first steps.
The mothers of tigers, however, seem to have taken different approaches to raising their children. Siberian tiger Bagheera was seen carrying around her four cubs, proudly showing them off to the camera near the enclosure. Fifa, the mother of four Bengal cubs, took a more protective approach and was not as willing to expose her cubs to the gaze of onlookers. Siberian tigers are extremely rare and powerful predators that live in far east of Russia and in northern regions of China. They are listed in the Red Book of Russia and IUCN as endangered species, following the devastating impact of poaching on the breed's numbers. Bengal tigers are one of the largest living cats that can be found in areas of India, Bangladesh, China, Nepal, and Bhutan. Although their population count is much higher than Siberian tigers, they are still listed as endangered.
A suspected serial killer was arrested in Kenya following the discovery of several bodies at a quarry in Nairobi, with police saying on Monday he had confessed to killing 42 women, including his wife. Police said Collins Jumaisi, a 33-year-old man living near the quarry in Mukuru neighborhood in the south of the capital, was arrested early on Monday.
The suspect was tracked down after analysis of one of the victim's mobile phones, Amin said, in a joint operation by the DCI and the National Police Service. As officers swooped, he was in the process of luring another victim.
The suspect confessed to have lured, killed and disposed 42 female bodies at the dumping site. All murdered between 2022, and as recent as last day, 11th of July, 2024. Unfortunately, and this is very sad, the suspect alleged that the first victim was his wife.
At Jumaisi's home, police said they found several mobile phones, identity cards, a machete they believe was used to cut up the victims, industrial rubber gloves, rolls of sellotape, and a dozen nylon sacks similar to those in which the victims were found. Since Friday, nine mutilated and dismembered bodies have so far been retrieved from the site of an abandoned quarry in the Mukuru slum, a gruesome discovery that has horrified the nation. The suspect, Collins, is expected to appear in court today.
55 years after man walked on the moon, those responsible for that one giant leap for mankind launched a space program that captured America's imagination. As commander of the Apollo 11 mission, Neil Armstrong became the first human to set foot on the moon on 20th July 1969.
The Apollo 11 astronauts' euphoric moonwalk provided Americans with a sense of achievement in the space race with Cold War for the Soviet Union, and while Washington was engaged in a bloody war with communists in Vietnam. American astronaut Michael Collins, who was a pilot of the Apollo 11 command module, stayed behind, while Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin traveled to the lunar surface to become the first humans to walk on the moon. Nearly one-fifth of the world's population had abandoned work or defied sleep to watch the astronauts' first exploration of the moon. To date, spacecraft from just four other countries have ever landed on the moon: the former Soviet Union, China, India, and most recently, just last month, Japan. The United States is the only one ever to have sent humans to the lunar surface.
Still to come in sports, heroes welcome for Spanish men's football team back on home soil. The Spanish men's football team arrived back on home soil on Monday after their Euro 2024 triumph and celebrated by parading through the streets of Madrid in an open-top bus. Luis de la Fuente's side were greeted by tens of thousands of cheering Spaniards as they made their way around the city.
Thousands of people in Madrid welcomed Spain's squad home on Monday after they beat England to win Euro 2024. After receptions with King Felipe VI and Prime Minister Pedro Sanchez, La Roja were paraded through the capital city on an open-top bus. The likes of Lamine Yamal, Nico Williams, and Sunday's match winner in Berlin, Michael Oyarzabal, wore white t-shirts with the number 4 on them in reference to the record number of times Spain have won the European Championship. The team bus took them to Plaza Cibeles in central Madrid, where thousands more fans waited to celebrate the success, following on from victories in 1964, 2008, and 2012.
Still in football, Germany striker Thomas Müller said Monday he was drawing a line under his 14-year career with the national team following the conclusion of Euro 2024. Müller, who turns 35 in September, was a key member of the German team that won the 2014 World Cup, beating Argentina in the final after extra time.
Following Müller's announcement, German coach Julian Nagelsmann lauded his qualities as a player, adding that the German team would miss him very much. Müller won the Golden Boot at the 2010 World Cup in his debut year, with the national team scoring 5 goals at the tournament in South Africa. The charismatic striker also scored the opening goal in Germany's famous 7-1 victory over the hosts, Brazil, in the 2014 World Cup, on their way to lifting the title. Of the players to have won the World Cup with Germany that year, only goalkeeper Manuel Neuer is still involved in the national team setup. Germany and Real Madrid midfielder Toni Kroos announced before Euro 2024 that he would retire from football after the tournament. Unlike Kroos, Müller will continue to play for his club Bayern Munich, where he is under contract until 2025. Germany's 2-1 loss to Spain in the quarterfinals of Euro 2024 will go down as Müller's last game for the national team.
Moving on to tennis, Rafael Nadal returned to competition for the first time since his early French Open exit on Monday, teaming up with Casper Ruud for a doubles win in Bastad. It was Nadal's first match since the 38-year-old fell to Alexander Zverev in the opening round at Roland Garros on 27 May as he prepares for the Paris Olympics.
The Spaniard and Rude 25 won 6-1-6-4 in the rain-interrupted clay court match against second seeds Guido Andriozzi of Argentina and Miguel Reyes Varela of Mexico. Wildcard entries, Nadal and Rude, who trained at the Rafa Nadal Academy in Mallorca, looked at home on the Swedish clay, racing through the first set with two breaks. Nadal lifted singles title in Bastad as a 19-year-old in 2005. This month, he skipped Wimbledon to focus on the Olympics, which will be played at Roland Garros, where he won 14 French Open titles. In Paris, Nadal plans to compete in the singles and doubles with Carlos Alcaraz, winner of Wimbledon tournament on Sunday.
In Formula One, world champions Red Bull celebrated their 20-year anniversary at the Goodwood Festival of Speed on Sunday. Past and present Formula One drivers, including reigning world champion Max Verstappen, drove various Red Bull F1 cars in front of the crowds.
Joining Verstappen in the parade were current F1 driver Sergio Perez, team principal Christian Horner, Red Bull F1 driver Daniel Ricciardo, ex-Red Bull F1 drivers Christian Klein, Mark Webber, and David Coulthard, Red Bull Chief Technical Officer Adrian Newey, and F1 Academy driver Hamda Al-Kubaisi. In Red Bull's 20 years in Formula One, they have won 6 constructors' titles and 7 drivers' crowns, the last 3 with Verstappen. Verstappen is currently leading the driver standings in the 2024 F1 Championship after 12 races with 7 race wins.
Tour de France leader Tadej Pogacar said he expects fireworks in the final week of the Tour de France after he hit his highest numbers ever in Sunday's final climb. The UAE Team Emirates rider highlighted his climbing credentials in the Pyrenees when he rode solo to victory in Sunday's 15th stage.
Slovenian Pogacar dropped Visma Lisa Bikes Jonas Vingegaard on the final climb, finishing 1 minute and 8 seconds ahead of the Dane, his closest rival to win his third stage on this year's tour and second in a row.
And we climb with as many riders we can because we have super good team. So yeah, I think for sure they will try. Yeah, Jonas said yesterday that he is not giving up on the fight, and I think that's correct what he said. And it's gonna be tough final week, and we're gonna see a lot of fireworks for sure from everybody.
Pogacar will be hoping to defeat reigning champion Vingegaard to win his third Tour de France next Sunday.
That's it for World Today this time around. In our top story, EU announces sanctions on 5 extremist settlers, or rather extremist settler Israelis. I'm Daryl Baptist from the River to the Sea. Palestine will be free. Thank you for watching. Now it's back to you, wherever you may be. Goodbye.